There's a holy expectation for what you're about to do. Full of awe and adoration, we wait for you. We wait for you. There's a people on the altar. What we offer you will use. Would you breathe on this surrender? We're here for you. We're here for you. Your power, oh Spirit, come have your way. Let this be a generation set apart. We'd be known for who we worship. We live for you. We live for you. We live for you. We live for you. Come now, Spirit of God, stir in our hearts, light up revival. Heavenly flame, here in this place, unleash your power. Oh, Spirit, come have your way. Oh, Spirit, come have your way. I don't want to miss what you're doing, when you're moving, where you're leading, Holy God. You have all. I don't want to miss when you're speaking, who you're reaching, who you're healing, Holy God. You have all of my attention. I don't want to miss what you're doing, when you're moving, where you're leading, Holy God. You have all of my attention. I don't want to miss when you're speaking, who you're reaching, who you're healing, Holy God. You have all of my attention, Holy God. You have all of my attention. Come now, Spirit of God, stir in our hearts, light up revival. Oh, Spirit, come have your way. Rain down, heavenly flame, here in this place, unleash your power. Oh, Spirit, come have your way. Come now, Spirit of God, stir in our hearts, light up revival.
Hi there. I am Nani Vett. I am Pastor Brian's wife, and I just wanted to take a moment to show you my 2020 vision board. This is it, and this is what I think about it. Yep, sorry. Well, if 2020 has taught us anything, is that we overcomplicate things. And this upcoming year, or this year that has already started, 2021, we want to make things simple. And making things simple can be something radical. And I hope that during this series, we can find the beauty in the simplicity and being radically simple. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we sometimes overcomplicate things, and we ask you to help us find the beauty in simplicity. We don't want to miss what you're doing, how you're moving, and what you're saying. You have all of our attention, God. And we ask that we may be overwhelmed by the peace and love that only you can give. In your name we pray, amen.
Jose, what's up, bro?
What's going on, man?
I'm glad you could, you know, take from your time. We can meet here and kind of talk about things. Anyway, I have my mate, right? Tea talks. What are you drinking?
I got some café con leche from Graciano's.
Nice. That looks really light.
It is. Actually, it's kind of dark.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like my coffee dark, but okay. It's pretty good.
I know you live in Homestead, so what made you make that drive from Homestead, like 25, 30 minutes to Miami Temple? What was like, yo, I gotta go there?
Well, I grew up in like Hispanic churches, right?
Right.
And my home church used to be this really small church. I grew up there my whole life, pretty much. Mm-hmm. And I felt kind of stagnant there. Yeah. I wanted to make a change, my spiritual life. Want to grow a bit, so I left that environment, I was kind of church hopping for a while. I church hopped with my family for a bit. They'd just come along with me, and I was going to like here and like East Hialeah and like other churches and stuff, but it was like totally different experience when I heard a sermon in English, like in person, because I always grew up in Hispanic churches.
Right.
And I just liked the atmosphere here. Very different, like the big church feel. And it felt good. I felt like I was going in the right direction. So yeah, it is pretty far, but.
So you planted your feet.
Yeah.
You're sticking it through.
Yeah, yeah. I was, you know what? I guess.
Awesome, man. I would say heavily involved with Pause. Tell us a little bit about that. What do you do there? What do you like about Pause?
Well, same thing. Going back to like growing up in a little church, mm-hmm. We didn't have a lot of youth. The youth, for the most part, was like me and my sister, my best friend Willie, mm-hmm. And like a couple other people, but like very small. And I just felt like the youth wasn't very, our youth group, our youth programs weren't very youth focused.
Yeah.
It was like, if you showed up to one of our youth groups, it was like four or five youth and like all of our grandparents.
Okay.
You know, literally it was like that. So yeah, I don't know. I felt weird. It felt, you know, and I kind of grew up in it, but I was like, I've seen other like youth groups, like mm-hmm. churches full of youth and like youth events and stuff.
Right.
And when I came here, Pause was just kind of starting out, mm-hmm. Or it had been going on, but it was like once a month. And I missed the first one, so I was like, I gotta stick around another month to get to the next one. And yeah, it was like, it kind of blew my mind to walk into, like, we did it in the fellowship hall. And I walked in, and it was like all the lights and like the snacks and stuff, and it's like full of people, and I was like, this is incredible. You know,
you made it, man.
Yeah, I was like, this is it. So yeah, I liked it. I liked that feeling. I'd never really been like in something like that other than like youth retreats and stuff like that. So yeah, I said, her like, stick around. I like Temple, I like the pastors. I like that it ended early. So a bunch of stuff. And I started going to Pause more regularly. And I met Ashley, the Pause leader. I met her through the discipleship group, because that was another thing. Temple was having a lot of like different things going on. And I like that. I like to be, have something else, like to be involved. So yeah, I started going to the discipleship group. That's where I kind of met Ashley. And from there on, they started having Pause every Saturday, or not every Saturday, every one Saturday of the month. And they were planning on expanding it. They're gonna start doing Thursdays and stuff. And they actually came up to me and asked me if I wanted to be part of the leadership team. And like, I remember that when they asked me, when Ashley asked me, I was like, I was super, like, I was not expecting it.
Right, because you're in discipleship class, right? To be discipled, not to, you know, disciple other people.
And I hadn't, you know, I wasn't like here, like, to be honest, like, I knew Ashley and Blair and a couple other people, but I didn't really know a lot of people and stuff. But yeah, I mean, I jumped at the opportunity of it just because it was something that I liked, something that I believed in. So yeah, I mean, that was a little while after I came in. So the majority of my time here has been with Boz.
Gotcha. And that's kind of like what's kind of cemented you here and gave you a sense of maybe community within the church. I like that, Jose. You personally, have you ever had to go through like an experience where you've had to give something up, you've had to sacrifice something? What did you give up? What was that like? Are you happy with that decision now?
That is a bit of a that took a quick left,
I went Oprah,
left turn.
Oprah on you.
I feel like, I mean, I've definitely feel like I've had to give sacrifices. Like, I've had to give things up. Even like before and through high school and like college and stuff, and now college now. I feel like I've had to sacrifice a lot of friendships, a lot of relationships, and a lot of time. You know, I have, you know, gone astray and come back on the path and back and forth. And I feel like I prioritize, when I want to get close to God, I try to prioritize everything around that. Right? So it's like friendships that aren't helping me get closer, or friendships that aren't helping me let go of things that I need to let go. You know, I have to give those friendships up, in the sense that, like, I'm not giving as much time into them. And I'm not, you know, I'm giving up, I'm sacrificing going out with friends to be here at church and do something. You know, Tuesday nights here in discipleship, and Thursday nights at Pause, you know. And it doesn't sound like much when you think of it. It's like, oh, two nights out of the week, right? It's like, oh, I work full time and I go to school every other day that I'm not here, you know. So it's like, I give up, in a sense, I'm giving up my free time to do this. But I've noticed, like, being part of Pause and being part of the community, it doesn't always feel like a sacrifice. You get me? There are times where it's tough, like having to let go of some friends and stuff like that. But other times, the sacrifice feels a lot easier. not always at first, but I have felt it, like, now I'm, it's like, I can't think of not doing pause, mm-hmm. you know, so yeah.
Gotcha. So that's good. And I guess my follow-up question to that would be, was there ever a time where you had to give up that a relationship or something of that nature, where perhaps it was influencing you in a way that you knew, you know, that's not what I should be doing. I should be doing this other thing. And you briefly touched on that, but at the same time, were you ever able to find like some kind of guide, some kind of either a person or a group of people that were able to kind of support you through that change of saying I have to let go of this for the sake of that?
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever have that?
Definitely. I mean, there's a lot of habits I had to give up, a lot of things that lifelong things I'd been used to always doing, that I was like, if I want to continue, I have to let this go, right? It's holding me back. I feel like through every season, I've kind of, if I look back, I've had someone or something that was there helping me out, whether it be Pastor Nelson, the discipleship group we had. Mm-hmm. That was a big help in a really tough time that I was going through. And it's like they were perfectly placed there. We were we understand that like none of us are perfect,
right?
And just being in that accountability group, being in a group where it's like we share experiences with each other, and we're both kind of we're all aiming for the same goal, it really helps out, because there are times that like you feel like you're falling, or you know, like you're falling behind, and it's like someone else gives you that push, they pull you up, you know. Yeah, I mean, I've been through it with been times where it's like my best friend, where he's there for me,
mm-hmm.
Or even my parents at times. So yeah, I feel like I definitely haven't been able to do it on my own.
Yeah.
And of course, I mean, that's like aside from like the spiritual aspect of it, right? That's like, it's like two different things. But yeah.
Yeah, no, I love that you mentioned that, because sometimes we're prone of wanting to solve our own problems.
Yeah.
And honestly, you know, tell me if you agree or disagree with me, but there are some problems that don't necessarily have solutions that you just kind of have to live through.
Yeah.
And that's what makes, you know, a discipleship group, an accountability partner, you know, a close ties to, you know, your parents and family and a best friend that can kind of help you through those problems, not necessarily solving them, because some don't have a solution, but being there, I think that that is key. But part of that, and correct me if I'm wrong, is you have to be willing to accept that invitation, right? Because it wasn't like, it's not like, I would imagine it wasn't you who started the discipleship group, right? Someone else started it. And so what was that like to get like the phone call or the text of saying, hey, you want to join us? What did you feel like? What did you feel like when you accept? What were your feelings when you first got to the group? You know, tell me a little bit about that.
Well, the discipleship group, that was it was pretty interesting, because it was in a time where I felt like I was very spiritually motivated, right? I felt like I was in a good momentum.
Uh-huh.
I was making a lot of strides in my spiritual life and stuff.
Okay.
It was kind of, it was very close to when I first really started coming here.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, they painted it out like it was maybe like 2 months they were announcing it.
Mm-hmm.
It's like this big thing, discipleship.
Mm-hmm.
That, you know, we're going to be walking, doing life together. They did a great job at announcing it. And I remember the first, it was like you filled out the connect cards and stuff. And I actually didn't get any like notifications until the day that they started it. Mm-hmm. Because for some reason they had like a different email for me.
Okay.
Like completely, it was like a completely different name. I don't know what happened. But I think one of the pastors I called,
mm-hmm.
Called me, because I had told him before that I was interested in it. So he's like, let me call, because I haven't heard a confirmation from him or anything. And I remember it starting off, like I showed up, I didn't know anyone really at the church. At that time, I really knew no one. And I showed up and it was like full of people. It's a bunch of us. It was maybe like, I want to say it started off with like 30, 40 of us. And it was a little nerve-wracking, but it felt good. It was deep. It felt like they were going somewhere with, you know, it wasn't like sugar-coated Bible verses and like just skimming over. They were like going deep into the word. I was super excited. I felt good about it.
Yeah.
It eventually dwindled down, ironically, to 12 of us.
Yeah.
The 12 disciples.
The 12 disciples, yeah.
it was good. It's definitely, I put it as like a point, like an occurrence in my life that definitely gave me like a changing point.
Yeah. Ask you, you know, you brought up that you were at a good momentum in your spiritual walk, like, yo, you were going places, right? What sparked that spiritual growth?
That spiritual growth, I'd say,
like, what woke you up was like, hey, Jose, stop messing around, look.
Yeah. I felt like I kind of hit rock bottom in the sense, like, spiritually, like you know, you kind of just you're like going off the path. Mm-hmm. This is like relationships wise, and I hit a point where I was like, I kind of like hit the ground, and I was like, I like looked around, and it was like that one moment of clarity. It was like what am I doing? And I feel like it's kind of easy to feel like you're getting a lot of momentum when you're coming from a place like so far away. Mm-hmm. Because even like the slightest improvements, you look back and it's like
huge milestones.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what was really like, you know, because it was like if I took one thing out of my life that was like messing me up at that moment, it was like, you know, if there was 10 things, it's like I took one thing out, it's like 10% already. I'm like,
yeah.
You know, it felt like I was another thing. I was like, so.
Yeah, you were sprinting through a marathon.
Yeah.
That's good. Yeah, thanks for sharing that, man. That was very vulnerable of you to do.
Oh, yeah.
and just to kind of keep going with this, the theme, by the way, Jose, and the reason that, you know, we're speaking today is because I think in all of our lives, in one way or another, there's a moment where we have to give something up. In your case, it seems to have been like that relationship that kind of sparked the dramatical growth, right?
Right.
The incremental walk back to where you felt like you needed to be.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's always like this falling out, either with a relationship, with a friendship, with work, with yeah. God, that kind of gives us like that moment of like wake up clarity, and you're like, what am I doing here?
Yeah.
And right after that, it seems like there's this moment of calling out, where either God calls out to us, or we call out to God, or we just cry out for help, period.
Yeah.
Or we receive that call from someone else inviting us into a space where we can begin to grow, we can begin to heal, we can begin to move forward. And I think that is kind of like the last step, right, is this the sense of, you know, falling out of that relationship, but also calling out for help, you know. And at the same end, where you receive that guide that you're calling out for, you get this chance to move out, right, to actually do something. And I feel like that's the growth pattern of our character, in a way, is that, okay, once you called out and you were helped and you've been here for almost three years, and you're at this place where now you're moving out. You're moving in the direction of being a leader, leading out in pause, being willing to come and do a conversation like this, and having the courage to be vulnerable, to speak about the moment where you had a fallout, right? Speaking of that and being honest about it, because you understand that that's not something to be ashamed of. Mm. You know, that's something, hey, that happened in my life. And, you know, if we're talking to young people here, that happens to, I think, 99% of us, where we have a fallout, specifically speaking, with a relationship with a girl or a boy, right? And I really appreciate you sharing that with us. Last thing I want to ask you is, you know, what's something that you're passionate about?
Passionate about?
Yeah.
Oh, man. That's always a tough question because, I don't know, it's not something I think about. Mm-hmm. And, like, I want to say I'm not passionate about anything, but I am passionate about, you know, a lot of things, I'd say. I just feel like it's never the right answer.
Yeah.
Like, it's not the answer people are looking for.
You're cool, man. Try it. We're all
no, good. Yeah, yeah. But, like, I mean, I love projects. I love doing things. I'm always up to something that I probably shouldn't be doing.
Okay.
Like, getting myself into situations for no reason.
You know, when you said things I shouldn't be doing, all the parents watching kind of gasped.
That's not what I... That's not...
Oh, my gosh. That's... What?
Yeah. I bought, like, a beat-up, destroyed truck just because I want to work on it because that's what I like to do. It's something that entertains me outside of the normal, mundane stuff.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, I'm passionate about... I grew up not having that support, that youth support.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that I said, like, if I have the opportunity to be able to help someone else that, you know, when I was their age, I didn't have that support. I never really had someone that was not an adult, like not like an adult of the church, but I was older that could like guide me or mentor me.
Yeah.
It was always like, you know, the elders or the pastors or like my dad or my grandpa who was a pastor. It's like, you know, but I never had someone that I could like talk to and relate to in times like now.
Yeah.
Or a community that would like, that I could feel like I was a part of. So yeah, I'd say I'm pretty passionate about changing that atmosphere.
That I like that, man.
I didn't grow up in, so.
That's awesome. So to summarize, you're passionate about building and renovating things, as well as creating support groups for young people.
Yeah.
In essence.
In essence, yeah. It's a lot, I don't know. It's not a midlife crisis thing, but like I look back and it's like there's a lot of things that I wish I could have had. Like in that essence of growing up, that I want to give back now. My sister's not that much younger than me, but it's the same thing. It's like, man, I want to like, I hope it's not too late for me to kind of like make an atmosphere where she can grow up in that I was like, I was lacking, that I wanted when I was growing up.
That's awesome. I know I said last thing, but you know, pastors, we say last thing, we go on for another half hour. but is there something that's going on right now in your life?
I am working on a couple of things, but I definitely say I started a book club.
Okay.
Well, through Pause. And that's completely the one thing that's in, like, blown my mind the more I think about it.
Mm-hmm.
Never really read books.
Okay.
Never joined the book club.
Mm-hmm.
But I woke up one day and I was like, I told Ashley, I was like, I have this vision, I have this idea, don't know why, but, and so yeah, we have it Saturdays at 4.
Okay.
Just started through Zoom, reading Seculosity. So
that's the name of the book?
Yeah.
Okay.
Very interesting. You want to know what it's about, hop on Zoom at 4 o'clock.
All right. And, yeah. And who is this for?
It's really for anyone. I'd say it's through Pause. It's definitely centered through our youth. But yeah, you know, it's
so we're young talking adults, young people, youth. And young adults are at least maybe in college.
Yeah.
Young professionals, perhaps.
Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, it's a good book so far.
Yeah.
Pretty interesting.
Okay.
And we just started, so it's not too late to hop on.
Can you give us like a little glimpse of the book?
No, I mean, it's about you know, society's not as non-religious as we might think it is.
Okay.
So religiosity hasn't gone down, but Christianity might have.
Okay.
So yeah, it's, you know, how we focus other things, how we make other things our religion rather than God.
Wow.
Okay. So yeah, very eye opening.
Yeah, that sounds very interesting, man.
Yeah.
I'll try to make it.
Yeah, yeah, you should. You should.
All right, man. Awesome. All right. Thanks for sharing, Jose.
No, thank you for.
I think that's it. You can get off the hot seat.
This is for the busted heart. This is for the question marks. This is for the outcast, so lost control that no one knows. Sing it for the can't go back. Sing it for the broken past. Sing it for the just found out life is now upside down.
If you're looking for hope tonight, raise your hand. If you're feeling alone and don't understand. If you're fighting in the fight of life, then stand. We're gonna make it through this. The new romance, sing it for the loved in vain, overcame, it's not too late. Together we are bolder, braver, stronger.
So sacrifice causes us to fall out, call out, move out. What do these things mean? Stay with us as we dive into this topic.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as you're guiding us through your word, as we've listened not only to conversations about this, but as we also worshiped in song, Lord, help us at this time to be receptive not only to your words, but to your calling. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Paul, the Apostle Paul, man, he's such a crazy figure. When you first hear about him in the book of Acts, particularly when you see his conversion, right, and that whole story in Acts chapter 9, it's something to marvel at. It's something to kind of take a moment back, and it takes you back to a place where you can humanize this great apostle that's written so many things, that had done so many things for the church. And so what I want to highlight here are three things that I feel we all go through. We all experience these three things as we go through sacrifice, as we either sacrifice something or we see something being sacrificed. And the three things, the three areas that I feel we face is the first one, falling out. See, Paul experienced there on the road to Damascus. He was there going, getting ready to travel 6 days just to continue to persecute the Christians that he had already apparently finished persecuting in Jerusalem. So he's traveling 6 days, and the Word of God doesn't tell us where he was on that trip, whether he had just started the trip or he was just a mile away from Damascus. But the point is that Paul experiences God. And what we see there in the text is that he says that as he was traveling, it was midday, the brightest time of the day where the sun is brightest. And there is where the Son of God showed up to him. And the Son of God was brighter than the sun itself. And it says that Paul falls down, literally. So he has a literal fallout. And at this moment, Paul, yeah, he is blinded. He's blinded by the majesty and the truth of Jesus. And at this moment is that he begins to honestly realize what is going on. And we have moments like this in our lives where we fall out, where we all of a sudden are faced with a situation where we quickly realize that what made sense before no longer made sense, that something is not right, that something does not add up, that something is wrong. They told me they loved me. I thought I would have financial freedom. We go through moments in which we think, man, I thought this would bring me fulfillment. And we have a fallout where we quickly look at things. As Paul had a fallout and quickly looked at his life, at his ministry, at what he had been doing, and said, something has gone wrong. I missed something. And he has a fallout with his previous beliefs. He has a fallout with his culture. He has a fallout where things don't add up unless he changes completely. And perhaps your relationships haven't added up, and so there was a moment where you had to sacrifice that relationship. Perhaps your job didn't add up, so there was a moment where you had to sacrifice that job. Perhaps school didn't add up. Perhaps many different things didn't add up. And there was a falling out. Sacrifice leads us to a fallout, where there's something that we fall away from. But this sense of this idea of sacrifice, where, you know, something has been either sacrificed for you or you have sacrificed something, provokes a falling out, a total turnaround of what you yourself thought you were or what you yourself thought someone else was. And there we hit the next hurdle. See, in sacrifice there's a fallout, but there's also a calling out. And like the conversation you just listened to, where Jose and I are just talking about, you know, Jose's life, he says something very special. He says that for him to look forward, for him to move on, for him to accept God's calling, there had to be a moment where he hit rock bottom. And it's that moment where we hit rock bottom that we are attuned to all the noise around us, but also we are especially attuned to the gentle whispers. And it is here where where Paul falls out and he's taken into the city and he's there for 3 days, that he feels a calling out. See, in every movie, in every great epic, in every hero's tale, there's always someone, there's always someone, there's always a guide that comes up and calls them out of their current predicament, calls them out of their situation. There's a moment in every hero's life where the fallout causes them to see what is truly going on. And for Iron Man, the fallout meant that he saw what his weapons were really being used for. In other tales, like those of the Hunger Games, or those of the Maze Runner, for those that were part of these different series, where they realized that there was something wrong that they needed to give up. How long did they have to live just simply to keep surviving? And so that fallout led them to this call out, where in all of these epics, there's a guide that calls them out that says, hey, you know that there's something wrong. Come out of there. Let's do something together. In every good story, you have this guide that calls the hero out of inactivity, calls the hero out of depression, calls the hero into a new role. And here's the interesting part, that the guide already knows what the hero will become. The guide already knows what the hero is purposed for. See, Ananias here in chapter 9 of Acts, where you see his dialogue with God. God already shows Ananias, this is my purpose for Paul, but Paul had no idea. In like manner, we need to be able to see the purpose in our young people. We need to be able to see the joy that it will be for them to take up a new role. And when we see that, when we actually take a time to usher them into this new role, when we take the time to prepare them before they had to take on this role, when we take the time to truly disciple them, we'll see great results. And here, Ananias already knows what God's purpose for Paul is. And what the story vividly represents, if anything, under this clause of, you know, calling out, if the story represents anything, is that it describes Ananias as someone who is just a disciple. We don't know anything about him before this portion of the story. We don't know anything about him after. All we know is that he was some random disciple whose name was Ananias, who was called to call Paul. And what this story shows us, if anything at all, is that there is no limitations for God. It doesn't matter how evil you are, because Saul was truly evil, and it doesn't matter how insignificant you are, because Ananias truly was pretty insignificant to the entire plot. Until God calls him to call Paul, there are no limitations of what God can use. There's no limitations of what God can do through you. And so, as each sacrifice requires a guide, also each sacrifice involves responding to that guide. See, you don't just have a fallout. You don't just leave something when you sacrifice. Sacrifice also involves, like, when I left that and I had that falling out, I hit rock bottom, and now, God, what am I going to do? And God calls you to move out. God calls you to get on the move. And this is where most Christians really get stuck, because it's not that we don't move. It's that oftentimes we're moving in all the wrong directions. And what would really ground us is this simple question that I know many of you think that you ask yourselves, but let's be honest with ourselves, we really don't. But with a really sincere heart, if we were to come to God and ask, or when God comes to us, ask, what will you have me do? That is what Paul asked God. And in some versions, it doesn't appear, but when you look at the actual context and the Greek writing, you'll see there that that is very much said, whether it was said verbally or in the intention of what Paul says. This is expressed, what will you have me do? Then Ananias says the same thing, but in a statement, he says, here I am. And here's our problem is that when God calls us to do something, typically what we end up doing is we say, all right, God, what is your purpose for my life? It better be something magnificent. I want the end goal. We're always looking at the end goal, and God is going step by step. Paul doesn't become Paul out of nowhere. Saul doesn't become Paul out of nowhere. It takes incremental, small steps to get him there. And here we have our story, where I know that many in my generation or close to that generation of millennials, we tend to look at the world this way, that we are paralyzed because we think that our next move has to be our biggest move. We're paralyzed because we think that we have to become something great. We have to become bigger and better than our parents. We're paralyzed by the sacrifice that others have done for us to get here. We're paralyzed because we feel like we need to achieve the end goal in the next step, whereas God is simply calling us to take one step, one small step. This is seen in the story because the moment that Saul becomes Paul, the moment that he is baptized, the moment that you read the story, what's the very next thing that he does? The story says that immediately Paul goes and speaks at a synagogue. And we're like, wow, but there's no wow moment there. Don't you understand? Paul did this on a regular basis. Paul spoke at synagogues at a regular basis. He immediately does what he's always done. And in fact, he does such a bad job that the people listening want to kill him. And so this is where I'm going with this, that moving out doesn't always mean that you're going to get to the end goal. You're going to be the biggest, the best, the brightest. It means that you're willing to make that initial step. We don't have to get there at once. At the end of the day, this is what I leave you with. That sacrifice, yes, there's a fallout when sacrifice occurs. We hit rock bottom. And God calls us out. Yes, sacrifice requires there to be a falling out, which creates the opportunity to call us out. It creates the opportunity for us to call out for help. It creates an opportunity for us to be called into purpose. And it's a driving force that keeps us pushing forward. So I ask you tonight, I invite you tonight to take a moment and with a sincere heart, ask God what your next step should be. Ask God, in light of all of this, what will you have me do? Heavenly Father, Lord, what will you have us do, God? We feel at many times as though we have had to sacrifice so much for you, that we've had to sacrifice so much for others, so much for your church, so much to be a disciple. And yet, God, we do this and with a mindset of reaching the end, reaching the goal, reaching the best and brightest that we can be, whether that's a doctor, a pastor, a teacher, a mechanic, or whatever. And Lord, you don't call us to be the best. You just simply call us to take the step. The role of the best is already taken. The role of the brightest is already taken. Jesus is that role. And his sacrifice, God, help us understand it. Help us live in light of it. That whether it be a fallout, whether we're being called out, but please let us move out in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Thank you. And thank you for worshiping with us. We are so happy to have you here. And if you are looking for community, make sure to follow us on Instagram @thecollectiveempty and click that subscribe button. We look forward to seeing you.